Well, you're probably just as excited as I am to return to our study in the Gospel of Mark. And why not? It's been a great study, thrilling all the way through. But today we're going to do something even better. We're going to look at, for the next 2 weeks, our Lord Jesus Christ and how He handpicked His 12 disciples. We're going to look at how He chose the men that would turn the world upside down. Who were they? Why did He pick them? And what qualities did they have, unique or maybe not so unique, that made Him choose them? Well, I think the answer is going to surprise you.
What in the world makes us so embarrassed about the gospel? I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Now for this morning, I want you to open the Word of God to Mark chapter 6. Mark chapter 6. For you that are visiting with us, we're working our way through the Gospel of Mark and having such a wonderful time doing it. Every Sunday morning when we come together, we spend time with our Lord Jesus as He is the theme of every paragraph. How enriching and wonderful it is. And this morning we come to a section that begins in verse 7 of chapter 6, Mark chapter 6 and verse 7. It has to do with the calling of the 12, or the sending of the 12, really, on a sort of a short-term internship mission. Now for us to get the whole story of the sending of the 12, then we're going to take the beginning and the end and leave the middle story of John the Baptist for the future. Let me read then the pertinent scripture, beginning in the second half of verse 6 of chapter 6. He was going around the villages teaching, and He summoned the 12 and began to send them out in pairs and gave them authority over the unclean spirits, and He instructed them that they should take nothing for their journey except a mere staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belt, but to wear sandals, and He added, do not put on two tunics. And He said to them, wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave town. Any place that does not receive you or listen to you as you go out from there, shake the dust off the soles of your feet for a testimony against them. They went out and preached that men should repent. And they were casting out many demons and were anointing with oil many sick people and healing them. Then comes the story of John, and we'll pick up our account in verse 30, at the return of the apostles from their short-term mission. Verse 30, the apostles gathered together with Jesus, and they reported to Him all that they had done and taught. And He said to them, come away by yourselves to a secluded place and rest a while. For there were many people coming and going, and they did not even have time to eat. They went away in the boat to a secluded place by themselves. In this very beautiful, very foundational act in which our Lord sends out the 12 on their first preaching mission, we have essentially the seeds of ministry principles that come to full bloom in the rest of the New Testament, particularly in the book of Acts and in the epistles. How we view ministry begins here. This is where we have the foundational beginning implications for the nature of ministry that is so important to all who preach the gospel. Here we see Jesus, the perfect leader, delegating His message and His power to the first generation of gospel preachers, His first representatives, namely the 12. Here is the start of what we know as church leadership and gospel ministry. The Lord delegates to chosen representatives, 12 of them, the responsibility of representing Him, of taking His preaching and His power to the villages and towns and to the people of Galilee. Up to this point, He has done it all. All the preaching, all the teaching, all the healing, all the deliverance from demons, all the raising of the dead, He has done. Everybody, in order to experience His teaching and experience His power, had to be where He was. That made the crowds larger and larger and larger, and the larger they got, the more limiting and confining they became, and the harder it was to get to everyone. The pressure of time, the tremendously increasing crowds, make it clear to Him that He needs to divide the responsibility. He can multiply Himself 12 times if He will delegate the truth and delegate the power to the apostles and send them out, so that this final opportunity, this final gracious extension of ministry, is vastly more pervasive as they take up His place and His role from town to town and village to village. He has to diffuse the single nature of His ministry, diffuse the single crowd phenomenon, and take the message to the towns and villages in a multiplied fashion. It's time now for these men who have been in training by being with Him day after day, 24/7 for months, for no doubt well over a year. They know what the message is. How do they know? They have heard it every day, repeated all through the day, day after day, week after week, month after month. And Jesus, as we know from the gospel record, told the same stories in different settings, made the same analogies, made the same points, calling people into His kingdom of salvation. They knew the message. Now, Mark gives us the sequence as to what's going on in chapter 5, the double miracle of raising Jairus' daughter from the dead, 12-year-old daughter, and then healing the woman who for 12 years had been hemorrhaging. Then Mark says, after those monumental miracles near Capernaum, Jesus made a visit to Nazareth, 25 miles to the west and the south, which was His hometown. This is the second time He went to Nazareth. The first time they tried to kill Him after one sermon because He indicted their false religion and their corrupt hearts and told them that they were a generation like past generations with whom God could do nothing because of their hard hearts. They didn't like the message. They tried to throw Him off a cliff and kill Him. Remember when He called the apostles back in chapter 1, verse 17, He said He would make them fishers of men. As many as 7 of them were fishermen. Now was the time for them to begin fishing, to cast their nets. So in verse 7 it says, He summoned the 12 and began to send them in pairs. They had already been selected as 12 of His disciples who would be elevated to the level of preachers. He had many learners, many followers, some true long-term followers, some false short-term followers. But from among the true long-term followers, He chose 12. There were more. There were more. Luke tells us in the 10th chapter of Luke that later on He selected 70 more of His followers and sent them out on a short-term mission. So He had a lot of disciples to choose from. But 12 were elevated to be preachers. We know them as the apostles. They had 4 phases to their calling. First of all, there was a heart calling. There was the Spirit of God working in their heart that drew them to follow Christ. They were interested in Christ from the very outset. There was nothing coming at them from Him. It was all the secret, quiet work of the Spirit of God in the heart. They were drawn to Christ. That was the first step. They began to believe in Him, to believe in Him as possibly the Messiah, teacher from God, the prophet from God, and they were drawn to Him. Secondly, He then called them to follow Him permanently. He reached out to them and said, "Come after Me, and I will make you fishers of men." That's the second phase. The third phase was He elevated these 12 to the level of preachers. They were not only called to him, they were to be sent by him, which is what apostle means, a sent one. They then were going to be transitioning from being students to being preachers, from being learners to being messengers. Well, here is the fourth feature in their preparation, their first mission trip as interns. There will be a fifth phase. That will be the final sending, which happens after his death and resurrection when he meets them on the Mount of Olives and sends them to Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. So here we are at point four in the preparation of the apostles, their short-term ministry, where they go to represent the Lord Jesus with his message and with his power for a short time to return and report to him. And when they report to him, they will then receive further training based upon that report. Finally, after all of their months and months of listening, it's their time to repeat the message. And they are sent. He summoned the 12 and began to send them out in pairs. They went in pairs for obvious reasons, mutual support, mutual protection, to make everything they said confirmed in the mouth of two witnesses, to blend their unique gifts and talents and skills, and to bring double witness to what they were going to repeat that they had heard and seen in Jesus. So, for all of those reasons, they went two by two. One other important note here that you need to consider, there is also a judgment in the commissioning of the 12, a very severe judgment in the commissioning of the 12. Jesus was a judgment preacher. Many things he did were acts of judgment. And it wasn't just making a whip and cleansing the temple, once at the beginning of his ministry and once at the end. It wasn't just pronouncing doom on the Pharisees, judgment on the Pharisees for their hypocrisy as he did in his Passion Week. There were many elements in his ministry that were acts of divine judgment, sweeping acts of judgment, and this is one of them. But it's against the backdrop of that nation that he chooses 12 men. Guess what? No priest, no scribe, no Pharisee, no Sadducee, no rabbi. Nobody out of the religious establishment is chosen. The religious establishment is corrupt. The very fact that he chose these men from the commonest of people, most of them being fishermen, the other common laborers, and you can throw in a despised tax collector and a deadly terrorist in Simon the Zealot, and you've got a very unlikely group. It is a judgment on the condition of the religious establishment that he can't use anybody in the religious circles. This is a judgment on apostate Judaism. When he chose 12 common ordinary men to be the first generations of New Covenant preachers, that was a condemnation of the Jewish religious system. The 12 apostles became, in effect, the leaders of Israel. How many tribes in Israel? 12. Now you know why there were 12 apostles. Not 8, not 10, not 6, not 24. There's symbolic importance here. There were 12 tribes in Israel, but Israel was apostate. Its leaders were apostate. The Judaism of Jesus' time was a horrendous corruption of the faith of the Old Testament. Their religion was legalistic. It was self-condemned, shot through with hypocrisy and self-righteousness. And Jesus picked men who were not at all a part of it. They weren't even rulers in the synagogue, local rulers. Having already pulled them out months ago, he now sends them out. And as they go, I want you to see the things that mark faithful messengers, okay? the features, characteristic elements of ministry that mark faithful messengers of Christ. For those of us who are called to this high calling, this is a strong, strong foundational teaching. First of all, number one, faithful messengers of Christ proclaim salvation. Proclaim salvation. Does that seem obvious? Well, it should be obvious. We just have one message. Just one message. I'm going to borrow from Luke 9. Luke is the parallel text. Matthew 10, Luke 9 have also this same sending out. And Luke 9 says this, He sent them out, verse 2, He sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God. He sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God. That's what John the Baptist did. That's what Jesus did. Jesus came to preach the kingdom. What does that mean? To preach the king and his subjects, the kingdom of salvation. What is the kingdom of God? It is the realm of salvation. It's the realm of the redeemed and the saved over which God rules through his chosen monarch, Christ, who is King of kings and Lord of lords. It's the message of salvation. If you go back in Mark chapter 1, he was preaching the kingdom. Simply that, the sphere of salvation is now available. The door is opened. If you'll come and put your trust in me, you can enter the kingdom of salvation and be under the beneficent and eternal and blessed rule of God. But you have to acknowledge me as your Lord. Then in verse 12, there's a second component added in their message. Verse 12 says, they went out and preached that men should repent. That too was a part of the message of Jesus as well as John the Baptist. Repent. That was the message that Israel couldn't swallow, because that affirms that they are poor prisoners, blind and oppressed, as Jesus designated them in Luke chapter 4, borrowing from Isaiah 61, that the gospel was going to be preached to the poor prisoners, blind and oppressed. It's not talking about physical conditions, it's talking about heart conditions, to those who realize they are spiritually bankrupt, who realize they are imprisoned to sin and death and judgment, who are blind to spiritual truth and who are under the oppressive threat of punishment. The gospel comes to those who recognize their horrendous spiritual condition, the deadly wrath of God about to fall on their heads. And the gospel says, repent, recognize your religious sins, your hypocrisy. That's what Jesus preached, that's what John preached, that's what they preach, that's what we preach. We preach that sinners must repent, put their faith in Jesus Christ to enter into the kingdom of God, wherein lies eternal salvation and eternal blessing under the sovereign rule of God. Kingdom is opened up. The implication pretty clear for us, right? We only have one message to give. We only have one source. We have one book with one gospel. We preach the message of salvation. The second thing they did, very important, and all faithful ministers of the gospel, all faithful messengers of Christ do it, they manifest compassion. They manifest compassion. Verse 7, back to verse 7. He gave them authority over the unclean spirits. Now, obviously, there's more than compassion here. That is an expression of divine power. But compare that with down in verse 13, they were casting out many demons and anointing with oil many sick people and healing them. So what did they do? 12 men went out to cast out unclean spirits, heal all the sick, and raise the dead. Staggering, staggering commission. They had all the power Jesus did over demons, disease, and death. These were the credentials of the apostles, the agents of our Lord Jesus Christ. They had these for the duration of their ministry. 2 Corinthians 12:12 says, these are the signs of the apostles, signs, wonders, and various miracles. Those were the unique credentials of the apostles. The only time any other people received such abilities. Why would they have those signs? Because that's what makes it clear that they are speaking divine truth. It's undergirded by these powerful expressions of miracles. Supernatural power then is to authenticate the message, but I think beyond that, it is to demonstrate the compassion of God as over against false teachers. Listen, do you think the people of Israel felt that their religious establishment was compassionate? I don't think so. Jesus indicted them and said, "You bind on these people burdens they can't even carry, and you don't even lift a finger to lighten the load." They had turned the Sabbath day into a day that was supposed to be a day of rest into the most hated day of the week because there were so many prescriptions people could barely do anything. They had added so many laws and rituals and routines and demands and commands that all of life was externally cumbersome. And so anybody who names the name of Christ, anybody who proclaims that he is a servant of Christ, anybody who goes as the messenger of Christ must first proclaim salvation and secondly show compassion. And true ministers do. They proclaim salvation, they manifest compassion. One more point, they live dependently. They live dependently. These first preachers set the model for us, verses 8 and 9. "And he instructed them that they should take nothing for their journey, except a mere staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belt, but to wear sandals. And he added, do not put on two tunics." Now here are the rules for the road, folks. Okay, you guys, you're going to go. Matthew adds that he said this, "Freely you've received, freely give." Don't put a price on your ministry. This is the principle of never charging for the gospel, never charging for the ministry, not seeking to be enriched by people, especially by taking from suffering people, which is so common among false teachers. The Bible, all the way from the oldest books in the Old Testament that mention false teaching to the New Testament, tell us false teachers all are in it for the money. They get rich off people who suffer. And listen, sick and suffering people will pay anything to someone they think can help them. People trade on that all the time. These would-be healers all over the place who have become filthy rich can't heal anybody. They can't heal anybody. But people will pay out of desperation. Can you imagine what they would pay if you could? Well, the 12 had to face that reality, that they would raise the dead, and they would heal all the sick, and they would deliver all the people possessed by demons. Then the temptation would be cash in on it. That's not how it's going to be. "Freely you received," he said to them in Matthew 10, "freely you give." By the way, everything that is mentioned here that you just sort of grab and go, you don't take an extra pair of sandals, you don't take an extra tunic, we'll see, you don't take an extra staff, these kinds of things were the normal things that you packed to leave. All of them are mentioned in Exodus 12:11. When the people were ready to leave Egypt, they had to go light. You have the same things mentioned there. They were leaving a pagan land, and they were going to leave everything behind and just take what they had in their hand and on their back. And it's the same thing here. And then he goes on to say, no bread, no food, no food. You're going to learn to depend on me. No bag, which means you've got nothing to carry the food in anyway. That's a backpack or a knapsack. No money in your belt. They carried money in their belt. Matthew 10:9, Jesus also said, and don't acquire gold, and don't acquire silver, and don't acquire copper for your money belt. Don't start selling your healing power. Take no money, take no extra clothing, take no bag to put anything in, you just go. This is, dear friends, high-level training in trust, isn't it? Wow. And don't take two tunics. A tunic is translated in Matthew 5:40, shirt. Outwardly they had a cloak, which you use as a blanket and to roll up and sleep on at night or unroll. Don't take an extra shirt, just what you've got. This is the stripping of every normal thing that you would assume you would need to pack an extra pair. Don't take a second pair of sandals also, the other writers say. This is the normal thing. Plan, prepare, accept what God has provided. Pack it up. Do what you're going to do. But for those 12 then, the lesson was on dependence. Go like the rabbis said that people were to go to the temple with no staff, no shoes, and no money. Go sort of symbolically bare before God. This is boot camp on trust. Well, if you want to be a messenger that stands in the long line of faithful messengers descending down from the apostles, proclaim salvation, manifest compassion, and live dependently. Well, there's three more principles here that we'll look at next Sunday. Well, Peter, of course, is well known for his denial, and there's little question about that. But he was fully restored by our Lord and became the great preacher in the early years of the church that poured out the gospel in the city of Jerusalem. And he was so faithful to the Lord that he died as a martyr, asking only that he be crucified upside down because he wasn't worthy to die like his Lord. Andrew was a friend. Andrew appears in the New Testament as someone who was concerned about other people and bringing them to Jesus. Well, the Apostle John, most people think of as a very weak, kind of drawn, pale person because that's how he's depicted in medieval paintings, and kind of mild-mannered. The truth is, he was one of two brothers with James who were called sons of thunder because they were so brash and so bold. They actually tried to ask Jesus to call down fire from heaven and burn up a whole village full of people because they weren't being kind to the Savior. Well, I kind of think of Philip as maybe the accountant in the group, even though he didn't handle the money, Judas did. Philip was the one who came to Jesus when the crowd was hungry and said, look, there are this many people and there's this much bread and we can't make this deal work. He was a bit of a skeptic. He was the kind of a guy like the CFO in the company who counts up all the beans and says, we can't do that. But he was overridden by the power of Christ. Well, Thomas gets a bad rap because you can hardly say the word Thomas without adding the doubter, and you even call people a doubting Thomas when they doubt something. But there is a whole lot more to the story of Thomas than that. There are things about Thomas that are just downright heroic. And one of the really enjoyable parts of writing the book, 12 Ordinary Men, was to free Thomas from the stigma that he's had to bear for a long, long time.